Peace marches in Canada are nothing new, a relatively few people holding a vigil or a demonstration. But in Vancouver, April 24, 1982, will long be remembered as the day 35,000 people walked for peace. For some, the day began by attending an ecumenical church service or a peace mass. Then all walked to a nearby park to join thousands who had already assembled to walk for peace. It should be mentioned that in preparation for the Walk for Peace, Marpole United Church hosted a banner-making party. 50 people, ranging in age from teenager to senior citizen, made banners and posters to carry in the peace walk. Let's talk with some of those who attended the church services.
I feel always convinced this is where the church should be, and I'm so glad to see the difference between last year and this year, that finally we're in here and showing that we're for peace, which churches should be for.
Well, we've got a lot of people turned out, and we've got the sun turned out, and it's been quite an exciting thing. People are very enthusiastic in there, and a lot of people I've never seen in a church before, a lot of people I've never seen in a demonstration before, so there's a lot of growth going on somewhere.
I think people who have never been involved in anything before are finally getting out and taking to the streets and saying, we're not going to stand by and let this happen. We're going to speak up. We're going to march. We're just going to keep at it until this insanity stops.
Right. We can stop it if we try.
Yeah. Oh, the Canadian Catholic Organization for Development and Peace.
And that's the really social action arm of the Roman Catholic Church.
Yeah, really, we're a development agency, but we really believe that militarization and the arms race is something that is really stealing from the poor and preventing development. So that's our particular perspective on this protest today.
And so I take it then you really feel the church's place is to be
oh,
here,
indeed.
To be seen to be involved.
Well, otherwise, what does it mean to go to church if you're not going to live it in trying to create the kind of world that we believe in?
Fine.
I'm pastor of the Peace Mennonite Church, and last Sunday we signed the World Peace Pledge, which says in light of our faith we're prepared to live without nuclear weapons in our country. And that's kind of an expression of where we're at. We feel not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord, and we want to live that way.
You're involved as a chaplain at UBC, and so you're involved in the church, but also otherwise. Tell us about
that. That's right. Well, I'm one of the co-chair of the Division of Mission in Canada for BC.
Yes.
And part of the responsibility of that division has been nuclear concerns, nuclear armaments and protests against armaments for a number of years.
Yeah, and it's not just Christians. It's also, I think, a broad spectrum of public opinion in which Christians are certainly involved, but are not the only groups. And I think one of the interesting things about the Peace March is that it's been able to galvanize and unite public opinion right across the spectrum. And I think that's very, very encouraging. It's a sign of real moral progress.
That's a turnout. Fine day, and I hope all the rest of the march, I think, have been blessed by us being here.
We are an answer. On February the 23rd, 1982, the Vancouver City Council passed the following motion: that the City of Vancouver hold a municipal referendum on general disarmament at the same time as the civic elections in November of this year, and further that the ballot on this issue read as follows: do you support the goal of general disarmament and mandate the federal government to negotiate and implement with other governments the balance steps which will lead to the earliest possible achievement of this goal?
I'm very pleased to accept this proclamation. My name's Frank Kennedy. I'm the president of the Vancouver District Labor Council. We have with us Dr. Jesse Chang, who's going to make a few remarks to the assembly.
And I will say to you, my dear friends, in the United States, the physicians are out in the front. The scientists are out in the front. And the businessmen and the church people are out in the front. And here I learned, to my great gratification, that the labor unions in Canada are out in the front. I indeed salute the labor union leaders of Vancouver, of Canada, and I think in the United States, the machinists are out in the front, and I hope and pray there'll be more labor unions that will be out in the front, because the laborers are going to make not weapons, but make things that will make our life a better life to live. And I also salute the church leaders of Vancouver. I understand the church people in Vancouver are very much responsible for this. And I salute to the church leaders of Vancouver. My dear friends, so therefore, I want to say to you, we have only a few years left. If we do not end the arms race now, in another few years, it will be too late to end. The question now is not whether we will have World War III or not World War III. In fact, the seeds of disaster have already been laid. And in fact, World War III, and I mean it in all sincerity, without least exaggeration, the World War III is already on its way. And what we really need is to stop World War III. So in the end, may I say that for Canada, the key thing is your entire right, I salute you, that no more cruise missile testing and no more military budget increase. These are the two things. And for United States, we are now determined to go ahead and arouse the whole country on the freeze the nuclear weapons. Because if we do not freeze the nuclear weapons, the first strike weapons, the doomsday first strike weapons will be on their way. In another few years, it will be too late to stop those first strike weapons. So today, right now, this is the kind of time, this is the kind of moment that we must stop the first strike nuclear weapons. In the end, I would like to quote Martin Luther King. In the end, now, Martin Luther King, before he died, he said, "We must live together like brothers or die together like fools." And Martin Luther King also said, and I quote, you all know, there's a song, we all know, "We shall overcome someday." And I would like to say, I want to change just a little bit. And this is my last sentence. God bless you all. What is it? We shall overcome in 1982. Yeah.
Instead of MIRVing a missile, you all know what a MIRV is. It's one missile with a lot of warheads which you can target independently. Instead of merving a missile, these scientists should be applying their brains and their energy to merving a cow so it'll produce more than one calf at a time, or to merving a stalk of grain so it'll produce more than one head of wheat at a time. That's what they should be doing. The fact that you're meeting here today means you're going to send a wonderful message to Ottawa. In addition, I would like you to write your MPs and write Trudeau and write McGuigan. Tell them you want three things that they should press for and push the United States. And in the General Assembly at the special session in June, they should urge as strongly as they can a mutual nuclear freeze on all nuclear weapons, on all of them. No more testing, no more production, no more deployment of any nuclear weapons. That's point number one. The second point, ask them that you want them to urge that there be major substantial reductions of all existing nuclear weapons. Move them instead of from the direction of infinity to the direction of zero. And the third point is that they should use the money they save from military expenditures, which, contrary to the popular myth, do not create jobs, but they lose jobs as compared to any other form of government expenditure. Tell them you want that money to be devoted to the developing countries and to all human needs.
Gonna stand for peace and not for war. In front of everyone. In front of everyone. In front of everyone. Gonna stand for peace and not for war. In front of everyone. In front of everyone. Gonna sing to stop a nuclear bomb. Along with everyone. Along with everyone. Along with everyone.
to the Trident Submarine Base in Washington State. And I bring you greetings from the people there who are resisting the coming of that first strike weapon system. I also bring you a warning. The first Trident submarine will be arriving at that base this summer. It will be 2 football fields long. It will be 4 stories high. It will carry 408 first strike nuclear warheads. We don't want it. We need your help to stop it. We're inviting people to come down and join us this summer to resist the coming of the Trident. The American government is trying to crush the anti-Trident movement. People are being arrested at the Trident base now for handing out anti-nuclear leaflets. Workers who take the leaflets are being given tickets by the county police. Our group is being denied permits to have our meetings. But what's happening is that the repression from the government is building the movement, and now the workers are doing their own leafleting on the base. The workers are helping us plan some of the demonstrations against Trident. The workers don't want Trident. And so we ask you, because the Trident will go through Canadian waters on its way to being deployed as a first strike system, we ask you to join us this summer in protesting the coming of Trident. Thanks.
I bring you greetings from people like yourselves in Toronto, who are trying to stop the manufacture of the brain system of the cruise missile at Lytton Industries in Toronto. It is good to walk with you this afternoon. It is good to be taking steps to end the arms race. So often, we remain bystanders. So often we sit and watch our television sets and watch the world go by and wonder where it is all going. It is no wonder that we are so often bystanders. Our parliamentarians not too long ago had the experience of bells ringing in their ears for days on end. Since Hiroshima, we have had alarm bells ringing in our ears for years on end. And we know what it feels like after those alarms for so long. We either muffle the sound or we go crazy. But today, we are doing something different. We are walking. We are taking a first step. We are doing something. It is a sad truth that many religious people, many good people, stood by at the time of Hitler when another Holocaust was being prepared and executed. We know now what happens when good people stand by or watch and go about their business. Millions are murdered. We are no longer innocents. We know now that in this age of technology, the greatest evils have been done by ordinary people, by thoughtless functionaries, while good people stand by and do nothing. We will not remain bystanders while another Holocaust is being prepared. We are walking, we are taking steps, we are here today. We who have been taught to believe that the experts are always right are saying that we know enough about living to say this: we want peace. We who have been paralyzed by red tape are cutting through all of that and saying clearly, we want peace. We who have been told, you are too young, you are too old, you are too left, you are too right, you are too male, you are too female, we are saying, we are human too, and we all want peace. For too many years, religious people, like so many others, have been bystanders in the face of a possible nuclear destruction. We have been quietly despairing. We have felt helpless. We have not had the answers. Yet faith has never meant having all the answers. Faith means simply stepping out, taking a step when we don't have the answers. We, believing people, take one step and another step and another step. Our faith means believing in ourselves as much as God believes in us. Our hope means believing in this world as much as God hopes in it. We look around us today and we say, yes, our earth is very good.
We, all of us here today, want to end the nuclear arms race. And we, the people of Canada and of many, many other nations, will end the nuclear arms race.
In June of this year, the United Nations are holding their second special session on disarmament. It's tremendously important that at that session that Canada comes out with this minority report. Because this report says we want a freeze. This report says we do not want the testing of flight vehicles. That cruise missile is one of the most dangerous weapons that mankind has ever conceived, because it can be put in the back of a truck. It has the power, seven times the power of Hiroshima. It is not verifiable. We will, if this weapon is produced 2,000 or 3,000 of a round, we will not be able to verify. We'll never get rid of nuclear weapons. So this is tremendously important. Now I say to you, we are on the edge of getting it. And politically we have to do something. And I'm saying it because I'm the only Liberal member who signed this report. But I know that there is a lot of support around the Prime Minister, and there will be support among other members if you do something. And I'm telling you what you have to do. The most important thing you can do to a member of Parliament is to send a letter, personal letter, to your member of Parliament in your constituency. He has got to listen. He's got to respond that letter. And if he receives a couple of hundred, he knows there's something going on. And that is one of the things I ask you all to do. It's got to be done in the next 6 or 8 weeks, or even less, than the next 4 or 5 weeks, because we want that. We want Canada to stand up strong and say, we want a freeze. We want to eliminate the possibility of a nuclear holocaust. Thank you.
It's naive to believe a first strike is any defense at all. It means swift retaliation, annihilation, as the world to fire falls. And all your armed forces and all your amens won't put the world back together again. As we're pushed to the brink, more and more start to think, for we must. From out of a dream, where we can't run, can't scream, we wake up, for we must break the silence.